hello, and welcome to round six of Pro Tour M15 here in Portland, Oregon. I'm Brian David Marshall. I'm joined by Pro Tour Hall of Famer Randy Buehler, and we are watching another Pro Tour Hall of Famer, Luis Scott-Vargas, as he prepares to play against Seth Manfield. What's the matchup, Randy?
So LSV is on the red aggro deck. Now, not the Rabble Red. Team Revolution is the only team I've seen so far that has gone all the way to Goblin Rabble Master, but they do have Stoke the Flame. They've got sort of creature-heavy red deck, red aggro.
And red aggro it is. Sacred Foundry, shock myself, come out of the gate with a Foundry, perfectly fitting Foundry.
Foundry Street Denizen,
yeah.
That was over the Satyrs, interesting.
Thought Seize looks at a hand of... More red creatures.
Yep.
Drinker, Fire Drinker Satyr, Fire Drinker Satyr, Found Street Denizen, and a Rakdos Cackler along with a Mutavault.
Yeah, 4 1-drops. His hand was 5 1-drops and 2 lands.
Yeah, not a second red source, yeah, though, for him to be able to get in for 3 the next turn.
Though the Mutavault may be able to chip away.
Yeah.
Seth Manfield on the other side. It says Black Devotion. This is actually the white version of the deck that does not have any devotion in it. It's no Gray Merchant, but instead you get, you know, an Obsidot, an Elspeth, a Banishing Light for value. But the real reason you go to white is 3 copies of Blood Baron and Viscopa.
Which is a nightmare card for this.
It's a good point. You go there for the matchup against the real Black Devotion decks, but what you get is you randomly get a 4/4 Lifelinker against red.
Yeah. It's very difficult for them to deal with. He doesn't even have any devotion in his sideboard.
That's what he called it on his deck list.
Yeah, he doesn't even have Gray Merchants coming in out of the side or anything.
He's got the 4th Blood Baron.
So there's the Mutavault. And we see a Rakdos Cackler off his leash. Get in for 2.
It's funny, like one of the ways you can make your opponent's Thought Seize is bad is by just not caring. Like, here's 4 1-drops. Like, if all your cards are kind of redundant and do the same thing, then Thought Seize doesn't... It's like trade a card for card, but they spent a mana and they spent 2 life, and all my cards are the same anyway.
Do you feel like something? You're looking at something wrong watching Luis Scott-Vargas play a Rakdos Cackler? Does it seem somehow out of character to you?
He's splashing for divination, right? I mean, there's got to be a blue splash in here somewhere.
Will forged golems.
It's the new Hexplate.
Yeah. So here we go. Here's a second Thought Seize.
I mean, Manfield's drawn him. He's kind of got to play him. Sure. They sting. I mean, I expect he'll sideboard them out.
He saves some more damage in the long run here.
Right. Yeah, and the Mogi's Warhound is a little bit better than the other cards. Sort of.
Sort of. That's already at 14. Here comes a Fire Drinker. Here comes another Foundry Street Denizen. Attack for 5.
Yeah.
Seth falls to 9. And, you know, nearly lethal on the table. Seth plays a 3rd land. Passes the turn. There's a Cackler.
Yeah, just more 1-drops. He hasn't played every card.
Attack for 10.
Every card Luis has played this game has cost 1.
I mean,
just
that's
all 1s.
That's how they drew it up in the locker room, obviously. So it looks like we're going to take a peek in on
Yeah, I think
Martin
we've got news. A promo queued up first.
Hunt Bigger Game. Magic 2015 is now available on Magic Online. Start your hunt by downloading the new Magic Online client at www.mtgo.com. Play Magic at a store near you every Friday. Earn Planeswalker points and battle against your friends in Friday Night Magic. August's FNM promo is Bile Blight. Visit wizards.com/FNM for more information.
All right, welcome back. It looks like we're going to take, while those guys are sideboarding, we're going to take a live look.
Look at that top left corner of that screen. It's Neil Reeves. He's back in the feature match here. He's kicking the hill and he's 5-0.
Yeah, well, we're looking at Martin Yuza versus Frank Karsten right now. Frank Karsten.
I've just seen those guys more recently than
another
I've seen
member
Neil.
Of the Hall of Fame. It's 12-16. That's the life totals right now. Martin's playing the green-white aggro deck that a lot of the European We've seen a handful of European players playing. And Frank Carson is playing green white aggro as well.
Huh.
So this is a mirror match.
Yeah, so Carson checked it, tested with, it's a lot of the Eastern European guys, right? The Czechs, the Slovaks, the Slovenian guy that won the Grand Prix last weekend. That team has a lot of talent, right? I mean, Big Z plays with those guys. Yuza,
absolutely.
Carson's been testing. There's a lot of talent. Stanislav Sivka. It's
Ivan
a good team.
Flock.
Yep,
a couple of former world team champions on that squad.
But yeah, they think green white aggro is the solution, which is kind of interesting. There's definitely a lot of different takes on this post M15 standard. There's a lot more going on than I think the naysayers were suspecting.
Yeah, I think there we see
Banishing Light.
Banishing Light take out the. I'm just trying to look up these deck lists here for a second. Yeah, Advent of the Worm. I saw that. We just saw that in another deck as well. Coming back here, we're talking about it's a card that won a Pro Tour, at the end of last season,
sure.
And then it's just been conspicuously absent. So Fleece Mane Lion, before it can get big, takes a Banishing Light.
Yeah, these guys are really close to the Craig Wesco mana base too. Not quite. I mean, they're
not playing 8 and 8 in terms of basic lands.
7 and 7.
Okay,
like very close. They have 2 temples and then 7 and 7 on the basics. Although that's what I was noticing. Like it was really stark. I liked your deck you did with Craig. And these guys came to very similar conclusions about the format. Their deck is maybe a little bigger than his. Pretty much the same. A couple of Sunblade Elves running around to stitch everything together.
There's an Advent of the Worm, but it immediately gets Selesnya Charmed.
Yeah.
The token gets exiled.
These guys are 4-1, right?
Yeah. Yes, they are. There's a... There's a Fleece Mane Lion, and this can get out of hand very quickly. It's like, find an answer right now. Don't let him untap.
Oh,
there's a second Advent of the Worm.
And he gets to untap with the ability to monstrous his Fleece Mane?
Yes, he does.
He's
no hurry,
good
too,
for
right?
Martin
he can sit and wait. He certainly doesn't have to do it yet. He can...
There's something to be said for doing it before Frank draws another card.
But if he just passes with his open mana, he can make Frank commit some mana and then...
Yeah, I suppose there's not... Is there no instant way in these decks to get it? He wants the damage.
Yeah. He's like,
I'll deal an extra point. Wow, King of the Hill. The most uncomfortable seat in the room is Neil Reeves is already down
those,
a game.
Those thrones are made of swords.
Yeah. Seen the, The one match we haven't talked about in this feature match area, by the way, the other 2-5-0s, not on the King of the Hill table. Did you see that matchup?
Wow, is that Andrew Cuneo and Owen Turtenwald?
It is. Ooh, Cuneo has 3 Detention Spheres in play. And a Jace.
His deck looking. I watched him play a match against Oscar Jones.
His deck's the same deck he's been playing for like 18 months, right? He's just like, he invented blue white control. Literally invented it.
Well, there you go. Martin Yuza takes the game against Frank Carsten. Advent of the Worm says, Yeah, I was always here. You could have been playing with me this whole time. We can peek in on the Cuneo match. I think we can just go to a still, we can just go to an overhead still shot.
Draw, play a land, go. Yeah, Cuneo is a... wow. Yep, that tells the story.
But like,
These guys are teammates. They're on Pantheon. Owen seems to have the black-white that most of the Pantheon is running, and Cuneo has stuck to the Azorius control.
Playing the Azorius control that most of the Andrew Cuneos have been running?
Yeah, precisely.
Okay, sounds like we're ready to go back to table A. We'll let these guys sit here and dry.
Might have another mulligan.
Yep.
What were the mulligans? I didn't hear.
It's easier if you could just tell them.
Luis is one more mulligan for Luis. That means it's a second, presumably.
Well, the way that their deck has been described to me.
Yeah.
Is if you draw between 2 and 3 lands, you almost can't lose.
Wow.
You draw one land, or four lands, you almost can't win.
Wow. Really?
Yes. It was described as a fairly high variance deck.
Crazy.
By one member of the team. Okay. We'll go back to the almost live look-in of blue-white control versus black
not
white
a lot
control.
There's not a living going on here, is there?
Yeah. A couple underworld connections.
Yeah, no, Owen can... The two underworld connections gives him some game here. And that means this board is a lot closer to a stalemate resolved. Than it probably looks. Go. Pack rat just resolved?
You're trying revelation
for... Oh.
Six. Yep. 26.
Never mind. Rev for six. Okay.
Underworld, overworld connections. Okay, these players are ready to go, so we're going to go back to our main table with Seth Manfield leading off there with a Godless Shrine. Go. And a high-quality mountain into Fire Drinker Seder.
Yeah, Beta's not good enough. Beta Artist Sign is apparently the new tech. But...
Yeah, it's a Pepe's the ultimate price for that. Lands. Oh.
Oh, Burning Tree and nothing.
Burning
follow
Tree
up.
Go is not the most sad play there. You get a look at Luis Scott-Vargas' Hall of Fame career.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah. Less than impressive Burning Tree Emissary. It's immediately Banishing Lighted.
See if Chandra's Phoenix lined up, though? That's not bad.
Two. 60 Flyer. There you get a look at Chandra's Phoenix. Card is a pain in the neck to deal with.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Banishing Light can deal with it, but he just used his Banishing Light, right? Seth Manfield have anything else?
Got a Desecration Demon.
Not looks a Desecration like Plague?
I do not think he went that deep.
There we go.
There you go, like a Desecration Demon. The guys out on the floor who are doing the... card entry, do yeoman's work.
And yeah, absolutely.
And sometimes you're you're like, ah.
It is tempting to laugh at them from time to time, but it's not a job I would enjoy doing, I know.
The demon gets Banishing Lighted. Chandra's Phoenix gets in, does what it does. But, you know, the magic number here for Seth is really five, right? Like, you really get, you know, you get scared at the red deck when the black white mid range deck gets to their mid range mana,
right,
and can start making Blood Barons.
Does not actually have a Blood Baron. Magic number this game might be six.
Huh. See another Banishing Light in his hand, Devour Flash, and the Elspeth Sylvan's Champion. Does have another land. Five. Here it comes. Banishing Light on the Chandra's Phoenix is not in, and oh, there we go.
Assume that's what he's thinking.
Yeah.
Yes.
There you see the dreaded four lands from Scott Vargas.
Oh, Devour Flesh going to eat a Mutavault here? Indeed.
Now he only has three. He's a lock.
21.
Plays another Mutavault. Plays a Fire for the Striker. Framer, there you get a look at young Seth Manfield, who's had a pretty good Grand Prix career so far.
Definitely.
Four. Bile Blight takes down the Mutavault.
Yeah, let's see chipping away, but he's still got a lot of work to do.
A second Firefish.
Six.
Oh.
There she is.
Pretty hard to imagine that Luis has a lot of answers here.
Right.
I know that
he's holding a mountain.
Yeah. Well, I didn't even mean in his hand.
I know.
I know sometimes this deck will side a little extra land in and bring in things like Banishing Light.
Sure.
And so we see a Banishing Light. That's actually what he's done.
Had to deal with the demon, though.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, the red aggro strategy needs to come out fast.
Yes.
It needs to come out fast. It needs to hit hard. It did not get to do that this game, so. Sure looks like we're going to be headed to game three.
Yeah, when you open up your hand and there's two lands and five just redundant one drops.
That was the game one draw.
Mutavault gets eaten by a striker. Three more tokens come down. Luis Scott-Vargas falls to eight, I believe. Yeah, that's enough. He's like, ah, that's enough. So, we've worked it out for you.
Yeah?
Randy, we're going to go take a look at Neil Reeves.
All right. King of the Hill, Neil Reeves. Knocked off Jeremy Dezani. But Greg Orange up a game.
But Neil's up 24-11 in this second game, so looking maybe good to force a game three.
Oh, so Greg's in his second Pro Tour. Top eight at Minneapolis, yeah?
Sounds about right.
How many Pro Tours has Neil played?
Neil's played in a lot, but it's been a long time.
It's been a while.
He won a PTQ to get
right
here.
Right, I saw that. I remember 32nd Pro Tour, I just heard.
Wow.
My ear. Thanks. Yeah, I know he did a tournament report. I remember the tournament report was floating around. I'm clicking this link. Like, the headline sounded like Neil Reeves won a PTQ, and I clicked the link hoping it was I was reading the headline correctly. Yeah, he's good times. I mean, he's particularly good times sort of on the side drafts, the late night drafting circuit.
Yes. Where would you say he sits on the all-time pantheon of limited players?
I mean, peak Neil Reeves is on the short list. Like, if you needed to build a team for a 3v3, you know, peak Neil Reeves is in contention to make the, you know, the team to play against, you know, whatever, the aliens that come down and make us play for the fate of the planet.
Okay, here we see a couple of dueling Jaces.
I find it particularly amusing that Neil Reeves beat Jeremy Dezani with Mono Blue Devotion.
he had a sweet brew for this tournament with Spirit Bonds and and Afara.
Wow.
And, you know, a bunch of stuff, and he felt like
he
played a lot leading up to this event.
I get that impression.
Yeah, and you know, he just really felt like he felt really good.
I was talking to him after the draft, and he just felt like, wow, people are, yeah, I was, this, it's like he remembers when he was just better than everybody else, and it, like, you could sort of see that glint in his eye, like maybe that was coming back a little bit. It's pretty fun. I mean, he's a humble guy, but you can see the glint.
People are certainly not, also, you know, he's one of those guys, not in a mean way, but, you know, not in a, but, like, he is a master of the mental game.
Sure.
You know, he
works that southern draw so well. He just, like, he can play the part of a hick.
Yeah.
He can look like it.
Players.
Yeah, absolutely. Lulls you into this false sense of security. 100%. I mean, it was particularly scary, like, back before he made a name for himself at the Pro Tour, people would, like, drive to Arkansas to play a PTQ, because it's got to be easy to win a PTQ in Arkansas, right? No. Neil wins them all. Just see, some guy with his drawl took me out in the finals. He must have gotten lucky. No, he's just insane.
Interesting. He chose to hit his opponent instead of Jace with the Night Vale Spectre. Wanted the card there instead, more than the ability to make that smaller. There's Thassa. There's Judges Familiar. Everything's online.
Uh-huh. This time Jace ticks down.
You can have a banish.
It's deicide. Oh yeah, no, Thassa's a little nervous here.
You have deicide or these two cards. Your choice.
It's an active Thassa. This is the reason Deicide was printed.
I mean, no mind game, so you're only going to go Deicide or no, right?
Right.
while that they sort out that Supreme verdict there. We're getting ready to go back to our featured table.
Okay, they have a new king
Scott
over there,
Vargas,
huh?
Scott Vargas and Seth Manfield. What's that?
They have a new king in a hill.
It's certainly looking that way. All right, there's the one drop leading off for Luis.
How's his hand?
Fire drinker Seder. We'll get a look at that in a second. There's the Seder. There's the hand.
Two lands. He wins, right?
Change of the rocks. Amogus' Warhand, a Chandra's Phoenix,
and
Chandra
Pyromancer. That hand looks like it needs a third and maybe even a fourth land.
Yeah.
Another Seder. Is this just comes into play tapped? That never happens. What is he? Did I misread the hand?
He's
just playing Mogus Warhound. Really?
Mogus Warhound, yeah.
That's better than Seder? Because next turn he could go. I guess if he draws the third land, he doesn't want to bother bestowing a Warhound. He'd rather play the Phoenix?
Yeah.
Okay. Plus, this gives him the option next turn to go chain plus Seder, which he doesn't get if he goes Seder there. Yeah, no. I think LSV, his line's significantly better than mine.
He's won a lot of line competitions in his day. Second land from Seth. Has at least a... at least one removal spell there. I think I saw. Here we go. So two Doomblades, Packrat, Hero's Downfall, and the dreaded Blood Baron of Viscopa.
Four lands? That's a...
Two more lands, yeah.
Two in play, two in his hand. Pretty good hand. I mean, he's trading...
He might only have one. That might be...
the land that's in play. Yeah, I was wondering about that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a solid hand. It's sort of the right mix of stuff. But you start to see, like, the way black gets an edge here is the cards are just cheaper.
Right.
It's like, if I can do two things on my turn, and then you have to spend your entire turn on one removal spell, then I get to hit you for some damage. Yeah, Mutavault was perfect. That is absolutely the perfect third land.
And Mutavault lets him play Chandra's Phoenix. Get in for four. Seth can feel it slowly slipping away.
Yep. He's taking two, four, taking six. Now he can, again, spend his entire turn on a removal spell, but he can basically only do one thing this turn. He's hoping that he can survive the Blood Baron. And Luis, that's the race, right? Luis needs to deal 20 before Blood Baron comes down. Luis basically playing for top eight here. I mean,
you could say top
25 would get him gold, which is slightly better than the Hall of Fame benefits because you wind up getting a flight and an appearance fee instead of just an appearance fee. But as a Hall of Famer, he's already got the invite. So most of the gold benefits are things that he already has acquired via the Hall of Fame. So it's really a question of if he can get to platinum, then, you know, his hobby pays him.
Right.
But he needs a top eight for platinum.
You see Seth really sweating a temple scry. Decides to put it on the bottom and play a pack rat.
Interesting.
No activation of Mutavault there. Pack rat just trades with Fire Drinker Seder.
Huh. Wow, two Seders. Just the ability, such a tempo deck. The ability to do two things on a turn. So powerful.
Two cards.
Mm-hmm. One of the things I love about Magic, you know, have games that are just like about playing one drops and
you know,
putting multiple creatures in play, or you can have a deck that's about like making nine mana to play a Genesis Hydra.
Right. Seth Manfield's been having a good season. He's already on 35 pro points, so he is gold. And if he top 25s, he gets platinum.
There's a pack rat. He does have a thought seize in his hand.
Wow.
Chose not to use it there.
You just smash into this pack rat, right? Whatever. Trade for one of my guys.
Yeah, absolutely.
Luis is probably...
He's thinking about whether or not he wants to smash in...
With the Mutavault?
With the Mutavault as well, or if he wants to maybe chain something to the rocks here.
That is what he's thinking about. he can...
It's alt undo.
He can do both, right? He can chain and mutavault. Isn't that the line? But then he doesn't play as Founder Street Denizen? Like, he gets to do two things again, which is exactly what he wants to do. He just has to decide which two. He elects for Foundry Denizen. I'm going to guess Denizen plus Mutavault, because it's kind of a waste of a chain to hit a 1-1 pack rat that's just going
right.
to trade with a Satyr.
Now you have two cards still.
You know what you can't chain to the rocks, though?
Blood Baron. Yeah. Question for a second for Seth about whether or not he was able to. Which restrictions were placed on his black removal spell? Yeah. All right, well, here it comes.
Blood Baron.
Yep.
That is the trump card.
What can LSV do about this?
Yeah. Seth traded as efficiently as he could. Ooh.
Oh, well,
that's what LSV can do
about
it.
We're going to stoke the flames.
M15, stoke the flames off the top, too.
That was about as perfect. Effect. As perfect as he, you know.
Jeez.
Just exacts his mana.
Yes.
And able to still get in an attack.
Oh, Owen Turtenwald has taken down Andrew Cuneo. 2-1. Sure, those teammates were not happy to run into each other, but
no.
You know what? Being 5-1 is still not terrible. Owen 6-0. He's been playing such good Magic lately. People have been waiting for him to make another deep run.
Yeah, and he 52 points on the season.
Yeah. Still hypothetically live for Player of the Year.
Hypothetically.
He has to go deep into Sunday.
He might need to go into Monday.
Wow.
Okay, here's a thought seize. Sees the chain to the rocks and the Chandra. But it drops Seth to 4.
Right. She's trying to...
Again, he has two removal spells in hand, but he's got to play them again, like you said, a turn at a time. Play Banishing Light. He can play Hero's Downfall on something, and then... But
he's just dead, right? Does he take 4?
Well, he can take... He can take 3
assuming Foundry Street Denizen's only 1. Oh, no, red
creature.
No,
there's a red creature, yeah.
That'll do it.
There's no way to get out from under that.
These decks didn't used to be able to kill Blood Baron, right?
No.
Like, all the 4s were to the face. Like, Boros Charm only went to the face. But M15, Stoke the Flames, means that Blood Baron is not the trump card that it used to be.
Luis said he needed to run pretty good for this tournament. And, that would fall under that category. Yeah, we're going to go back to looking at that Neil Reeves match.
Neil Reeves is still alive? How is he still alive? Remember we left?
We left and it looked really
bad. He
looked
down
for
a game.
Neil.
Supreme verdict resolved. Deicide was in hand, but apparently Orange is now on 3. And Neil is still fighting. He likes that seat.
I mean, if there's ever someone who is made to sort of stubbornly retain the King of the Hell seat, it's Neil Reeves.
Buy that.
Well, I guess he's scried a lot with Thassa.
How did Deicide not kill her?
He was holding a counterspell at the time.
That was his last card. It was a dissolve for the... Yeah. So I guess when we left... Supreme verdict resolved, but Deicide must have gotten dissolved. And then the Thassa scry plan. Yeah, fair enough.
They were good games. It's fine. I just drew better. I didn't really think we... Yeah.
Hearing player audio sounds like Juza may have finished off Frank Karsten.
Most important cards in that mirror there. Frank actually suggested we add a 4th soldier yesterday. This is good in the mirror. You just saw, like when a re monster is like the
place his Jace.
It's usually like a problem, but this guy just blocked it all day.
Yeah, so he can't even pressure you with it.
There's also a Jace in play for Neil.
Yeah.
thing.
I mean, often it's about like curving out well.
Yeah.
The person who does that also can have the advantage with stuff like Vanishing Light and Celestial Charm to push
right.
through.
Right. Off the board, we have more.
Martin Hughes did win, so this is our last 2-0. Match, Randy.
Makes sense.
Looks like Last Breath went into hand there.
That can pretty much decide the game on its own. If you blow your Vanishing
Light. And these guys are 5-0 at this point. King of the Hill on the one.
If they play Angel, then they cost you the game.
22-3.
The other one is doing.
Yeah.
We're not going to do that.
Yeah.
That's why I didn't play.
Neil needs to win this game if he wants to force a game three.
In case he had the Ajani, because he had like sort of a slower draw, so I figured like you might actually have this in your hand.
A little less than 25 minutes on the clock.
Yeah.
These guys might have a couple extra minutes
in
the future match.
Makes sense. Oh. That Jace with the 7 counters up there is the other thing that's going on. I didn't notice that right away. And that would be Thassa turning on again if that resolves. But it does not. Yeah, Jace memory adept. He's been plussing it primarily.
Yes. Architect of thought in play.
I mean, I guess with your opponent on 3, it's pretty tempting to finish them off that way rather than going for the deck.
You don't want to be a Milim and Kellum deck.
It's still an option. It's not like that option goes away. You just give him a couple of turns is all.
So divination and 2 lands.
Yep.
Yeah,
easy split.
Takes
the divination. Easy choice.
Ask divination. Step 2. Then a planar cleansing. And, I don't know if you see him playing Neil Reeves on camera. Can't afford any missteps. He's on that tight rope. There you see Neil. Whatever. Been here before. Faced longer odds. There's the planar cleansing.
The notes for Neil Reeves in the media guide we've got are perfect. Once considered the best limited player in the world. Two Pro Tour top 8s, both in 2002. PT debut 1997. Thing that's at stake for him, he wants to come back.
Yes.
He needs top 25 for Honolulu. That
top
is,
25 or, you know, get his, you know, he can work his way up to silver at the next one.
Right. But, you know. But if he's going to chain that PTQ into a return trip, he needs a top 25.
Still has to deal with Neil being able to sort of sculpt his hand every turn with Thassa's ability. Pushing all the chaff to the bottom.
Yeah. Greg Orange, first PT ever. It's his debut off the Minneapolis top 8. Also, I'm sure thinking about that top 25, especially with the 5-0 start.
Yeah.
You
got to be really careful at this point about letting that creep in, right?
Yeah, no. The real secret is just not to think about any of that stuff.
Yeah.
Just play Magic.
Don't be aware of the 3 guys operating cameras all around you, Craig Gibson clicking a shutter in your face, you know, people writing down every card you draw and what happens on their iPads. Biden to Thassa. And Mutavault gets in while Greg Orange's gates are down. Draws a card. He's 1 pip away from turning Thassa on. Well, you're going to make it unblockable.
Yeah, exactly.
I might as well be attacking. is at one. He does have a last breath in hand, we know. There's your...
Right till Spectre turns on Thassa if it resolves.
Night Vale Spectre gets gainsayed. Yell gonna attack into Last Breath. I don't think so. Not without a counter spell. Chooses to pass turn.
Yep. Like,
yep. I just need to get in with this once. I just need to protect one attack step. One unblockable Mutavault on the horizon. Objects on the horizon may be further away than they appear. Oh, here is Sphinx's Rev for Greg Orange.
Yeah, that life's going to come in handy.
Does it resolve? Yes.
Well, Neil lasted a lot longer than I thought he was going to last.
See a day aside.
Do you think Greg Orange really knows who Neil Reeves is? Feels like a legend from the past. Like, those of us who were around remember him. But he hasn't been around in a while. Like, is he somebody, is the legend loud enough that a Greg Orange would have heard about it?
I think, you know, his friends are going to tell him. Someone's going to know who he is. Greg doesn't know. The too little, too late department. Gainsay showed up for Neil. And sees another Thassa in hand.
Wow. Yep.
So look through the deck. What do we have here? How's your sideboard?
For a while, the running joke with the Dark Confidant, Neil is best friends with Bob Maher.
Yes.
And so with Bob Maher's invitational card, a lot of people claim that the artist was nice enough to put Neil in the background. The guy that Bob was advising.
Remember, Neil had that opportunity to say 10, 10.
10 yeah, no, he had Jace turns. For multiple turns and decided he was in a control fight and didn't want to just move all right. in on the,
right.
on the
he
deck
was,
you
He
plan.
Was scrying a card every turn, drawing an extra card every turn.
It made sense to
it
me.
Did make
it
sense,
did seem
yeah.
reasonable. It did not work out, however.
Okay.
He's just playing with his game, say, face up.
Just the slow work. Scry action. And, there's an Elixir of Immortality, which...
Well named.
Been a part of this deck for a while now.
Andrew Cuneo Tech.
Yeah.
He was definitely the first one.
Get in with Mutavault. Say, have that last. Oh, it doesn't even have last breath. He has a Sorius Charm. That's even worse. Yep. So, gainsay that.
A new one.
Gainsays it. It gets last breath in response. Maybe that represents an extra turn for Neil. A third Mutavault now for Greg Orange.
Do you know what Greg's friends call him? I don't know if they were messing with me or not, but in Grand Prix Minneapolis, his friends insisted that Greg Orange is the Citrus Assassin.
Well, if it wasn't true, it is now. This is sort of like being stabbed to death with a knife made out of an orange rind. It'll get it done eventually.
Neil does not seem optimistic about his Master of Waves chances of staying in play.
He's like, yeah, there you go, Master. But again, that's also Bob. Yeah, I mean, Neil's body language. Like, he doesn't want you to think that he has
a
plan.
Game's completely over. I'm just going through the motions. Game's completely over.
All right, fine. Supreme verdict. Look. Can't be countered. Destroy all creatures. Destroy all hopes. Neil draws another Master of Waves off the top. And it syncopated for a bunch. Neil counts just to be sure. All right, fine. Still, you know, a lot of turns left in this game. Go. Two Mutavaults. Down to 12. Three more turns. Neil doesn't even bother playing around. He just puts his island off the top into play.
And two Jace activations would have done it. Although, yeah, the game probably ends a lot sooner if he hadn't been drawing and playing the control fight. But Sphinx's Revelation. Good enough. Neil is done going through the motions now.
Okay, we have a new King of the Hill.
We do six rounds, five
different
kings.
The Citrus King.
I like it. The Citrus King.
So Greg Orange playing blue-white against Mono Blue. This has become a pretty classic matchup.
Sure.
Welcome back to the booth. Classic matchup from the Grand Prix circuit that we've seen over the last couple months. Is that how you've seen it play out?
Yeah, I mean, after sideboarding games, some mono blue players think of themselves as a beatdown deck. Some mono blue players try to sideboard their way into a control deck. Neil clearly went with the sideboard into a control deck. It tends to lead to longer games. I think that is the right way to play out that matchup. I know that Sam Black plays it the same way. So, I mean, I think
true then.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think it's close-ish. It seems like the kind of matchup to me where, you know, if one of the players is just better than the other guy, he can win it from either side. I mean, it's close-ish. I do feel like the edge goes to the control player in general, though.
So we're going to get a word with Greg Orange. We're going to find out a little bit more about him and about what it means to be the King of the Hill.
Yeah. Wow, you know who else is 6-0?
No.
Billy Jensen.
Oh, boy.
Huey wants to go to Worlds. He's had this awesome season with, is it seven or is it eight Grand Prix top
eights?
It's
eight Grand Prix top eights.
Eight Grand Prix top eights.
The previous record was Owens at seven, preceded by Kai's at six.
Yeah, ridiculous. But he hasn't had a deep run at a Pro Tour now, but 6-0 start.
Yeah.
This might be the weekend.
All right, so we're going to go down to the floor. Tim Willoughby has cornered Greg Orange and is going to ask him a couple of questions. Let's send it down to Tim.
Hello and welcome to the feature match area. I'm Tim Willoughby, here with Greg Orange. Looking pretty pleased, Greg, because this is your second Pro Tour, and this one going a little bit better than the last one, right?
Indeed. I went 2-6 the first time, so that's a bit of an improvement, I guess.
You've got the six, you've locked up playing tomorrow, and this is your first time in the feature match area, right?
Yep.
Now, how much do you know about the player that you were playing in that last round?
I don't know anything.
let me fill you in a little bit. Neil Reeves, he has two Pro Tour top eights, was for a while known as the best limited player in the world. So in some respects, you may have been lucky to play him in Constructed. it looks like today the King of the Hill table, not necessarily one that people can stay around in for too long because no one has managed to defend it for more than two rounds. But it looks like you're really comfortable with your deck. Do you think you might be the first one to be able to win more than a couple on in this feature match area?
I'd like to be. Sure. Let's do it. Why not?
And have you been playing this blue-white deck for a while? Is this something you picked up specially for this show, or is it...?
I have not played a deck without Sphinx's Revelation in it as long as it was in Standard, so...
I mean, it seems like a popular choice, and, you know, as long as people are still doing pack rats, as long as people are still playing with the Sphinx's Revelations, this is still very much the standard that we know and love, but There's two more rounds left today and plenty more tomorrow. Best of luck for the rest of the tournament, Greg Orange. We'll head send back to the studio now.
Seemed a little, he's like, wow, these lights are bright. But that's great. I mean, he acquitted himself perfectly, though, in the feature match area.
Played well. I mean, it makes sense. Fix his revelation. Run it. If that's your style of magic, it does quite well.
All right. We got two more rounds to go here. But in the meantime, we're going to send you back to the news desk and our own Rich Hagon.
As they used to say in the music hall, our very own, and you can keep him. Yes, Rich Hagon here, and two results to bring you. Jeremy Dizani was up against Daniel Antoniou, the Cypriot, only 18 years old, a terrific player, but Dizani dodged that particular young bullet, 5-1 now, for the number two ranked player in the year, who leads the Player of the Year race by one right now. Meanwhile, Reed Duke, he was up against Luis Lux of Venezuela. That was a 2-0 win for Lux, so that puts Reed Duke back to 3-3. I can tell you that in just a little bit during our dinner break, we've got Jeremy Dizani and Reed Duke together here at the news desk telling us all about their season so far. They came in on the eve of the Pro Tour yesterday to talk through all their highs and occasional lows of a phenomenal season for the two of them. Meanwhile, it is deck tech time once again. You better brace yourself for this. We've already given you Conley Woods with weirdness. We brought you Craig Wesco with green-white mid-range. Things are going to get seriously strange in our next deck tech. It's Alex Sittner with Zach Hill, and he's about to launch some fleets. Take a look at this.